Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Marco from the University of Nairobi, also practicing as the Iridian Eye Center. And today we are going to talk about primary congenital glaucoma, giving a general overview. Primary congenital glaucoma is a genetic condition which may be diagnosed at birth or in early childhood, which results in increased intraocular pressures and damage to ocular structures with inevitably loss of vision. How we classify primary congenital glaucoma? We have the true congenital glaucoma, which is present at birth. This is 40% of cases. And the IOP is elevated in the intrauterine life. However, most cases are the infantile congenital glaucomas, which manifest prior to the third birthday. And rarely we have the juvenile glaucoma, which develops after the third birthday to about 16 years of age, and even up to 35 years of age. True congenital glaucoma usually presents with very, very white or hazy corneas as seen. This is infantile congenital glaucoma, what we normally see, and the slightly older children who have the juvenile primary congenital glaucoma. So majority present at 6 months of age, 60%. And this is because between 4 to 8 months, the eye begins to increase in aqueous production. And most of them, 80%, are diagnosed within the first year. The clinical triad, as we know, is tearing, photophobia, and blepharospasm. Other signs are the buphthalmos, and as I said, it's usually asymmetric. One eye is larger than the other. They can also present with corneal scarring, Hab's tri, and increased corneal diameters. Some patients present with the mild corneal edema. This can present even when the IOPs are not very high, and sometimes this is what the child comes with. Also, when you do a gonioscopy, you're going to see an immature angle and also a prominent greater arterial circle. And if you're able to do a fundoscopy, you'll see optic nerve cupping, which is reversible after lowering the eye pressures. They also have very deep anterior chambers and have high myopia. So when you have a child with this condition, you want to examine this child under anesthesia to diagnose the glaucoma, classify it, identify any other primary etiologies, set a baseline for future comparison, and document findings so that you can develop a treatment plan and monitor the effects of the treatment. And you should only do an EUA if you plan for surgery, as indicated by your examination findings. As in, don't do an EUA and reverse the child. Do an EUA and do the surgery at the same sitting. We usually take the intraocular pressures under light anesthesia during EUA. We take the corneal diameters, do a slit lamp examination, though I usually use the microscope, do gonioscopy if possible, refraction, optic nerve head examination, axial length and central corneal thickness. For the index EUA, normally the corneas are quite hazy. I'm not able to do gonioscopies or refraction, and optic nerve head examination may be difficult, but you do what you can, depending on how clear the corneas are. Measure the intraocular pressures. If you can, use the Parkins within 1 minute of light inhalational anesthesia. If not, you can use the tonopen. You can also use a Shields tonometer. Sometimes the pressures are very low, especially because of the anesthetic agents, but they can also be quite high if you use ketamine, succinylcholine, or if the patient has a pressure from the mask and or from the speculum you've inserted. So have those all this in mind when you're doing the intraocular pressure. And this is the form that I use. I indicate on the top part what the relevant history would be. Anterior segment findings. Usually I use the microscope to do this. I indicate the IOP method, whether I use the Parkins or tonopen, and the timing for both the right and the left eye. Corneal diameters, usually the horizontal is enough. Axial length, indicating the confidence interval, as well as the central corneal thickness, gonioscopy, retinoscopy, and fundoscopy findings. And then I write my conclusions at the bottom. I also use this graph, which helps me document the axial length when the patient presents and the time at the age at which they present. And usually we want the axial length to be between these two lines. If it starts going up, like in this graph on the right, it means the IOP measure is not, IOP intervention is not adequate. So you need to ensure that the axial length is not increasing. So for medical management, it's a temporary role. It serves as a temporary role as you prepare the patient for surgery. And even after surgery, if your intervention, your surgical intervention fails to achieve the target, then you can add more medical management. Usually the beta blockers are good enough. The ones that I would say are absolute contraindications are the alpha 2 agonists, that's abimonidine, as well as the cholinergics, that's pilocarpine, because they have very high side effect profile and they can lead to more damage. The surgical treatment, angle surgery is a mainstay of treatment, and this is usually goniotomy, trabeculotomy, or combined trabeculectomy, trabeculotomy. For the goniotomy procedures, it's usually indicated when the corneas are clear, where you remove the obstructive tissue and you restore a direct flow of aqueous to the Schlemm's canal. And this is a pretty good procedure, especially in patients who present below 1 year of age, and you can achieve 64 to 79% very good IOP control. However, most times you have to repeat these procedures in the same eye. Trabeculotomy is where you rupture the inner walls of the Schlemm's canal using the Harms trabeculotomes. Very good IOP control in 90%. And you can also substitute the Harms trabeculotomes with a 6-0 proline and do 360 degrees trabeculotomy. My favorite and the procedure I usually do is a combined trabeculectomy, trabeculotomy, and I use antimetabolites, and it's quite superior to just trabeculectomy on its own. Very high success rate and very good long-term survival. If angle surgery fails, you can put the patient back on medical management or do a trabeculectomy with antimetabolite on another site. You can also use glaucoma drainage devices or cyclophotocoagulation if it's almost end stage. Or as a last result, if it's a painful blind eye, you can do an enucleation. Why do these children go blind if left untreated? They can have high myopia, easy globe rupture, retinal detachment, lens subluxation, corneal exposure, cataracts, corneal scarring, and can progress to adult glaucoma. I have two clinical examples. So this is a child who was diagnosed with glaucoma at birth. We did surgery at about 1 month of age. And this is the form that we filled at that time. The important thing is that the child was already on treatment, timolol, diamox, and azoct, which is benzolamide. The pressures were okay, but this was 5 minutes after inhalational anesthesia, meaning we had influence also from the lowering effect of the IOP lowering effect of the anesthesia. And you can see the corneal thicknesses were very, very thick, 786 and 831. So this is a child, we did surgery once, we did a combined trabeculectomy, trabeculotomy, we followed him up, he's now 9 years of age. His IOPs are stable between 15 and 16 millimeters, and he's well corrected with his glasses. Another child that we operated quite early, about 5 weeks of age, the child had high pressures, 20/24, was already on treatment, and very thick corneas, as you can see, quite a hazy view, we couldn't see much. And after we did the surgery, we brought the child in about 11 months later because we were not happy with the right eye. As you can see, the right eye, the pressures were still quite high. The corneas had cleared. And this is the graph. Initially at 5 weeks, the right eye was at the left eye was at 20.11 and it improved, but the right eye had increased in axial length. So we had to put in an AMED valve for the right eye. In conclusion, primary congenital glaucoma is a rare but devastating disease. If left untreated, it will lead to inevitably lead to blindness. And we need to diagnose these patients early and treat them promptly so that we can save these children's eyesight. Also, it's important for ophthalmologists to educate our colleagues in obstetrics, pediatrics, family medicine about infantile glaucomas, because the children are usually taken to these professionals first so that they can direct them to the ophthalmologist or refer them immediately. Thank you for your attention.